Donny Schatz has headlined a lot of sprint car rumors lately, but he's made his decision for 2024. We'll talk about that, plus what Rico Abreu has to say about whether he could be a series full-timer next season, and a lot more today on the show. Let's go. It's Thursday, November 2nd. I'm Justin Fiedler. This is DIRTRACKR Daily. Over in the merch shop this week, there are plenty of good DIRTRACKR items to pick up. I've got the three shirt options. I'm actually wearing one of them right now. On the lay model ones, discounted right now to just $7. Both the logo shirts, like the one I'm wearing, are $24.99. I've got sizes small up to 2X available. Also got plenty of the koozies in the four different color options. Those are $4 each. And if you want a sticker, you've got four choices there. The late model versions were just recently restocked to go with the under the lights and midget stickers. I've also got the new sprint car stickers as well. You can see the new sprint car and the late model ones here. And then the under the lights and midget stickers look like this. You can check out the store anytime. Grab something over at shop.dirttracker.com. You can also click the links below in the video description. And I try to get orders out same day. So if you put in an order today, I will ship it out today. The sport of dirt racing very much focused on World Finals this week here in Charlotte. I know it's not technically the end of the season for the entire sport, but for many teams, it will be their final races of the year. There are also no lack of storylines to follow, and the media has descended on the dirt track to take advantage of everyone gathering in one spot. And there are a couple of sprint car pieces to check out today that have been posted in recent hours from things around Charlotte. The first one I want to point you to is from Jeremy Elliott. He posted a story to SprintCarUnlimited.com just this morning about Donny Schatz' future plans. If you remember back to Monday this week, we talked about Corey Eliason's departure from the Crouch Motorsports 11 and talked through a few of the internet rumors about who would be taking that seat. At the center of a lot of that chatter was Donny Schatz. I had several people in the comments saying basically the same thing, and one even offered to bet me a beer that he'd be there. In that episode, I pushed back a bit on that narrative, saying that I thought there was still a scenario where Schatz stayed in the Tony Stewart Racing 15 for next season. And thanks to Jeremy's story, that's basically what Schatz is saying. He said, quote, "When Tony and I started on this journey, we both had an agreement that he would keep me in the car as long as I wanted to race. And I told him I would stay here as long as he wanted to do it. So I haven't decided to do anything different." He also said, "My plan is to stay right here where I'm at. Do I wish the performance was better? Absolutely. Is it frustrating beyond belief?" Schatz also confirmed that he'd fielded calls from other car owners, which is what we've been hearing, but clearly those deals weren't what he was looking for. So this will put to bed the Schatz rumors at this point, and also a few others that have kind of been floating around in this situation for scenarios that could have happened if Schatz were to leave. One of those being that Tyler Courtney was the top candidate to fill the 15 when Donnie departed. Sunshine, though, will continue to be in the rumor mill with his current situation for next season unknown. I wonder if I'll get that beer from that commenter after his wager. Go check out that story, SprintCarUnlimited.com. It has a bunch more stuff in there from Schatz about this tough schedule or tough stretch of races they've had as of late. The other story to read today is from Matt Weaver over at SportsKnot. Weaver has contributed to my email newsletter this season, The Slider, and he got a bunch of quotes yesterday from a number of players involved in the upcoming High Limit / World of Outlaws showdown. He talked to Brad Sweet, he talked to Brian Carter, and he talked to a number of drivers about the situation. It's a lengthy piece, but definitely worth reading. It provides a ton of information about how both sides are approaching this and what a number of competitors think about how this is set to play out. Weaver covers a lot of the things we've been talking about here on this show, including the midweek races, trips to the West Coast potentially for both series, Brad and Casey Kane going full-time High Limit next year, and a lot more. I'll link to it in the video description below if you'd like to check it out. One thing in there, though, that stood out to me were comments from Rico Abreu. As this split plays out in the coming weeks and months, both sides will be pushing to lock up full-time teams for next season. And I think a big hurdle for High Limit will be who they can convince to break away and race with them as full-timers. 11 midweek races where you have Kyle Larson showing up all the time are going to be much easier to promote versus a Friday or Saturday show that has a lot more competition and no young money in the pit area. Some star power would certainly help that, and a guy like Rico could be a big get for either side, whether that be High Limit or the Outlaws. But despite, some conversations that have happened in the past, Rico has never made the move to a full series run, instead choosing to make his own schedule. Rico did run the full High Limit season in 2023, but it was because those 11 races fit well into his already existing plans. He told Weaver, quote, I want to see what the World of Outlaws present all the drivers, and I want to see what High Limit presents all the drivers before I make a decision at the end of the day, but I'll ultimately be a true outlaw and just keep building this brand that I've built in the sprint car industry, unquote. So that sounds like unless either side comes out with something crazy for compensation for the teams, that Rico won't go either direction next year. And that's not surprising given his past, but you know, if I'm with High Limit or the Outlaws, I'm staying in touch with Rico all winter just to make sure there isn't a chance he changes his mind. His performance and fan base would be a big boost if you could convince him to join. I do think, though, there is a possibility that Rico would do that midweek deal. If for some reason there's a midweek breakout championship like we've talked about, Rico could run that again like he did last year. You know, obviously, won a ton of races, just barely finished to Kyle for that championship this season, so I think that could be a possibility. At World Finals last night, it was just hot laps and qualifying for all of the three series. Racing gets going for real today. And because of the cold temperatures, start times have been pushed up a little earlier each day. Opening ceremonies are set for 4 p.m. today and 4 p.m. on Friday, and then 3 p.m. for Saturday. Matt Shepard, Jimmy Phelps led Super Dirt Car Series qualifying in the Big Block Modifieds. And then Sheldon Hodenshield, Tyler Courtney, they were fast for the Thursday sprint car time trials, while David Gravel and Brent Marks went quickest for Friday. On the late model side, Thursday's program was led by Mike Marler and Brandon Overton, and Friday was topped by Scott Bloomquist and Dale McDowell. Obviously, Marler there with the Skyline Motorsports car, and Scott Bloomquist fast. You know, he hasn't run a whole lot this season, but definitely fast this week at Charlotte. If you can't get to Charlotte for World Finals this weekend, you can watch it live, all of it over on Dirt Vision. Some other sprint car racing to watch for this weekend is happening out west. Both the NARC 410 Series and the 360 Sprint Car Challenge Tour end their seasons on Saturday night. That is happening at the Stockton Dirt Track. Justin Cox leads the SCCT standings over Dylan Bloomfield and Caleb Montgomery. Corey Day appears to be on his way to the NARC title over Justin Sanders and Dominic Selzy. I'm not super current on how either point system works you know, at this moment, so I'm not sure what exactly both drivers need to do, but both have decent points leads, so I would assume that as long as everything goes to plan that those guys both should be crowned the champions for those series. Should be a great night for racing, great for those West Coast sprint car fans to have both of those series on one track on one night. Also, the USAC CRA sprint cars on non-wing have just three races left this season. Two of those will happen Friday and Saturday at the Cocopah Speedway in Arizona. That is for the Western World Championships. Brody Rowe already has eight series wins this season, and he's got a sizable lead in the championship over Tommy Malcolm and Austin Williams. The CRA competitors will close out 2023 on November 11th at the Paris Auto Speedway. That is down in Southern California. Down under in Australia, Perth Motorplex is off and running for their season. They'll be in action this weekend as well. Dane Kingshot picked up a sprint car win there a few weeks ago over James Inglis and Jamie Veal. Their show on November 4th will also feature late models, midgets, non-wing cars, and sedans. Clayperview is your place. They've got the live coverage of that one. If you're in the U.S. and want to tune into that one, you can certainly do that on Clayperview. Clayperview has all sorts of good racing from Australia, you know, kind of all winter long. So that'd be a good place if you want to check out some of that racing. All right, that's it for the show this week. Thanks to everybody that tunes in regularly and shares and comments on these shows. The support definitely doesn't go unnoticed. Hope you guys have a great Thursday out there. We'll see you right back here on Sunday.